To even get to this moment, we had to play over 300 series of World of Warcraft over so many weeks, and we haven't even figured out the most important thing. At this LAN, we will find out all of the teams who will be going to BlizzCon. And before I get to introduce anybody on the desk or talk about the teams that are actually going to be playing for those qualification spots, we need to talk about what they are playing for in general. As already mentioned, BlizzCon qualification. Not just one team will be going to, we'll be going first two teams. Also, $100,000 on the line. And now that we know everything that they're going to be playing for here, first place grabbing $50,000, I have the distinct pleasure of introducing everybody on the desk. My name's Rich. I'm going to be your host. And I am joined by Ben Aruki and Healing Staten for the first time. We got Pika here. That's the move. Let's actually talk about these teams, though. You've gotten to play against a lot of them. You've gotten to watch even more. What do you think about everybody that's here today?
I think these teams here today are the absolute best of the best in the entire game, and it proves it, especially since the regional tournaments are now half of NA and half of EU. So this is truly the best of the best. This is basically a miniature BlizzCon in one, and I'm really excited to see some games today. I haven't been able to play myself a little bit, and honestly, coming back here, seeing how hard everyone's trying and the excitement when people are playing, I'm ready to see some games today.
I think the thing you just said is so important to actually talk about, especially when we think about the entirety of the year. Basically, the idea of it being a microcosm for BlizzCon, I feel like we've had that environment throughout the entirety of the year. We've definitely seen these teams playing at a top level. And Elliot, I feel like there's one team that's played on the tippity-toppiest of that mountain of perfection.
You're talking about Method Black, I assume.
Yes.
Yes, they've had quite a dominating performance this year in literally every single cup of the 2019 AWC. They have made it to the top two. So that is very, very impressive for them. I think most of the teams in the tournament expect them to basically be the favorites to win. They've got the composition. They've got the practice. They seem laser focused on getting that first place finish and ultimately closing it down at BlizzCon.
Now, when we look on the NA side of things, we're going to see the Mew Mew Kitty Cats on the top of things. And, you know, if you maybe missed last season, that wouldn't be something that you were thinking about too much. Healing Staff, for anybody who missed that last season, why are they looking so good headed into this one?
I mean, you raise a great point. 7 out of 8 of the teams here at the Summer Finals, also at the Spring Finals, the one new roster there is going to be M2KC. And hey, for me, a lot of it's got to be kind of the return of the original villain, Jamili, on that mage. These guys have been absolutely incredible. They've been a force to reckon with. Their rogue, their mage, paladin composition has just been so aggressive, and it's really intimidating, especially here in this live environment. They play a very fast-paced game, but they can also drag it out, and I think because they have both sides to that coin, they're going to be a team that, I mean, really could contend with the likes of Method Black.
It's funny, when we've talked about that Fire Mage backed up by the Paladin, it has two strengths and they're at different points in the game. You almost have inevitability. You can go into that late game, but also it's going to be able to play those fast games. Definitely a scary composition to go into, but when we look at the entire field of play, what are the compositions that we're really thinking about, Pika?
I think right now, from the general consensus from most teams, is that Mage Rogue is by far the scariest comp out there, but people have kind of been figuring something out. They are starting to play with Frost Death Knights. I think so, a lot of Frost DK comps, Mage Rogue, and then the occasional Destrolock is probably going to be mostly what we're seeing.
And we are going to actually see what order some of this is going to be going down right now on our screen. And we talk about the Mew Mew Kitty Cats being a team we want to pay attention to. They're going to be going up against Wildcard Gaming to start things off. And Ben, what's the pulse on this matchup?
Well, I mean, like Pikaboo kind of mentioned, the Rogue Mage has sort of been the theme of the summer season. M2KC implementing that Fire Mage with the Assassination Rogue Holy Paladin. It's a really good composition. For Wildcard Gaming, they've struggled in the summer season. Europe has basically been a story of Rogue Mage Druid, and they've been that sort of X factor that's been trying to push through, trying to win against the Rogue Mages. We'll have to see what they have prepared here, because I think they're expecting the Rogue Mage Paladin from M2KC. I would guess that that is going to be their blind pick, and we'll have to see what Wildcard Gaming can come up with, because they are one of those teams. They have lots of different compositions. All of them can multi-class. Looney, obviously, phenomenal healer on lots of different roles, and like I said, we'll have to see what they do.
I feel like we could have a lot of fun on the desk right now trying to figure out what Wildcard Gaming is actually going to lock in here, but lucky for us, we're actually going to throw it down to the floor and hear if Io is able to glean any information from these teams.
Hey guys, I had a chance to catch up with both of these teams backstage, and apparently they haven't really been wargaming each other that much during practice. According to Rosita Jones, Wildcard has actually been dodging their request to wargame a couple of times. Also caught up with Morrow, and he said that they are a little bit bit worried about that RM Palacom coming from M2KC. And, you know, he seemed a little bit worried. He said if they were at the top of their game, they don't really think they're going to win. So we'll see how it pans out for them. Thanks, Rich. Take it away.
I think that sentiment is definitely understood, right, Healing Stat? And when we look at this matchup and we start to think, okay, how are these teams actually going to try to carve out their win condition? What are you thinking for each side?
I certainly think for M2KC, these guys are in the driver's seat, right? They come in as the number one seed from North America. Fantastic summer season for them. And I really do think their composition's scary. Like, we've talked about Rogue Mage Druid being something that's very typical in Europe. Obviously, here you've got a kind of slightly different flavor of the Paladin. It means that there's going to be more aggression, potentially. The Hammer of Justice is such a powerful stun that Rub Cub's going to be able to bring for M2KC in this first series. And I think because of that wildcard gaming, you know, they're going to have to draft a composition that not only can it survive well, but it also needs to be able to kind of end out the game, because Paladins also have fantastic mana going into the long game. They heal very efficiently. Holy Light is a very cheap heal, and it's also the most powerful because of the honor talents they run. So I think Wildcard Gaming's definitely got a tough series up ahead of them, but if they can win this might be one of the toughest series of the day for them as well.
Talking about it's all fine and dandy, but especially when you have a volatile force like Jamili in the arena, we know that the best thing to do is just to jump in and see what's going to happen. This is going to be the first game of the day. We're going to kick it off, and by the end of this weekend, we're going to know every single team that is going to BlizzCon from NA and EU. Mew Mew Kitty Cats against Wildcard Gaming.
Wow, really interesting. So for M2KC, they are going to be leading with their best foot forward, that Rogue Mage Paladin that they're really known for. Wildcard Gaming spicing it up. It's going to be a Fire Mage coming in from Marl, Blizzard on the Arms Warrior, and Ludi on the Mistweaver Monk. What do we think about this healing stat?
I am very excited to see this. Jamili has been on that Fire Mage the entire season. Maro meets him fire with fire. This is going to be a fantastic, spicy first game here at the Summer Finals Arena World Championship 2019. Maro looking to match Jamili, and as Rich correctly said, Jamili, you know, he's very impulsive, very volatile. He'll have good days, he'll have bad days. If he's on top form today, I think M2KC is going to run away with this one. But Maro has been a legendary mage throughout the European scene for many years now. He's going to try meeting mano v mano.
I mean, just looking at these two compositions going head-to-head, it seems like Wildcard Gaming, there's a lot of opening here for M2KC. Looney on that Mistweaver Monk, he's going to be really vulnerable. Of course, Maro, without the backup of a rogue and a paladin of his own, it's going to be difficult, especially if Rosies and Jamili are just shutting him down, training him, keeping him in the kidney shot. It's really going to be up to Blizzo to disrupt some of these goes and try to keep that consistent pressure rolling onto Jamili.
Yeah, certainly one of the big talking points for us this year has been who have been the best mages, Europe, North America, in the world. And one of the things that you've got to say for Maro is he's been holding his own in that conversation without having a rogue on his roster. And rogues do make it a lot easier for the mage. Big opener here. Jamili already falls into the ice block. This is certainly against the expectation. Wildcard Gaming with a huge lead.
Yeah, combustion from Maro, Avatar from Blizzo, massive damage. They were able to force out that first ice block from Jamili. Rub Cub with the Avenging Crusader. They're looking to get aggressive, but Looney, he's just positioned in a way where it's difficult right now for Jamili to really get crowd control. He's looking for the Ring of Frost, but he can't find it. Great positioning from Looney. Still good consistent damage from Jamili from Roasty. Maro getting a little bit low, but without crowd control onto Looney, he's going to be able to easily keep Maro alive. Maro now with the Temporal Shield. He lands a full Polymorph onto Rub Cub, and now it's Jamili on the back foot.
Yeah, suddenly, I mean, for M2KC, they've been running at Druids, running at Paladins and Shamans, all three of those healers the entire season. Looney brings out the Monk, and he can just max range. He can avoid Rub Cub and those Hammer of Justices. He's just sitting in the back line, keeping his team stable, and because of that, so far, they've had the better of all offense. You can see Rub Cub has used a lot of his healing modifiers. He's not got his Avenging Crusader for quite a while here, meaning that the next Polymorph, he's not going to be able to recover from it too easily. If they can land that, if Maro can push in, get that Polymorph, Jamili could be in a lot of trouble. He's playing fire. He has no ice blocks, man.
Ooh, nice double Dragon's Breath, Ring of Frost. Nicely done, but Rub Cub gets the ultimate sacrifice, denying that crowd control. Nicely done by Rub Cub, and now it's Looney in a Polymorph. Marl's going to have to play defensive in this situation. Temporal Shield rolling. Looney with no life cocoon doesn't really have too many catch-up mechanics. Now into a Hammer of Justice. Still Blizzo keeping up the damage consistently on to Maro in this game. And for Wildcard Gaming, this game is looking pretty good. Maro, he still has his ice block. Pressure seems in favor. The one thing I'm noticing M2KC has on their side is the fact that Rub Cub's mana is doing a little bit better. And I feel like that trend will continue as the game goes on.
Yeah, it's certainly true. Rub Cub on the Paladin does such a great job. You know, he plays for that late game as well. well as all the aggression that this team brings. So it really has been a good balance for M2KC, one of the many reasons that they are the number one seed here, representing North America at the Summer Finals. Full Fear now, Blizzo looking for the kill, forces the Divine Shield up, Blessing of Protection.
Whoa!
And they get the kill nonetheless. M2KC dropped out in game one.
Yeah, not exactly what we thought was going to happen to start things off. I don't think it was a wild card to start, thought was going to start off the day either. Pika, what the heck just happened?
That was actually, I was not expecting that at all. Like, Wildcard Gaming went into that game instantly forcing the ice block within, it felt like the first minute of the game, instantly putting M2KC on the back foot, and that completely disrupted their entire game plan, or even how they thought that match would have went.
Yeah, you know, when we look at the Mew Kitty Cats, we expect them to start off the day strong. We expect them to potentially have a very strong tournament based off of what they've been able to do so far in the season. But now you instantly start thinking about what it would be like to have a Sunday off. What was Wildcard Gaming actually able to do here? Why do we even see the Warrior in the first place?
I think the Warrior just is Blizzo's, what's what he's known for. He's the best Warrior in the entire world. This guy puts out more pressure than anyone else. His crowd control is always on point, and he's just always shutting down those CCs on his heel or keeping his team offensive, allowing his mage to get that crowd control onto Rub Cup, securing those kills. I think that's the main reason they're bringing it here. And just towards the end of this game, I think Rub Cup just ran out of cooldowns. All he had to really press was bubble at this point. He didn't have really anything to actually top his mage out of that CC, and it just was not enough in the end there.
I also kind of want to bring up something that we've heard from a lot of the different players, and that's like they'll talk about Warriors in general, and it usually ends in, and then I played Blizzo.
It was Jamili who said it.
You play against Blizzo, and it's just a completely different experience. He is so good at this class, and every time he's on it, he's a huge threat.
I mean, this is a team that was bringing Rogue Mage Druids to match point as Warrior Mage Druid in a matchup we thought was really not favored for them. So they can obviously play this class that maybe isn't as advantaged, but still really make it work. And I actually really like the Mistweaver pick. At first, I thought it was sort of a bad idea, but the Mistweaver makes it so Rub Cub constantly has to overextend, yep, as well as Jamili. So Jamili's using all of his shimmers to cross the map. The Mistweaver's able to create a lot of space, and as a result, Blizzo gets to have high uptime, and also Looney can bait Rub Cub into the open, and that allows him to get polymorphed.
Yeah, small thing too. I mean, Blizzo just with a fantastic transmog as well. That corrupted Ashbringer, not something I thought I was going to get to see today. Brought a small tear to my eye, but the more important thing probably going to be when we talk about healers in general, because I think Monk is probably rated among some of the healers we thought we probably wouldn't see today, especially with some of the changes coming into Way of the Crane. I didn't necessarily expect to see one. Do you think that we can see more of these Monks later today?
I honestly don't think so. I think this is going to be something that just Looney plays because he is just so stellar on that Monk. I mean, most of the top Monks you think about, people like Kohler in North America, Drainer in Europe, they didn't make it to this tournament. And part of that is because Monk isn't considered to be top tier. You know, you've got Paladins, you've got Druids, you've even got Shamans as a kind of quasi counter to the Mages. But Monks, you know, this was a pretty smart pick here. I think, as Venriki said, they're playing around the game of, you know, Jamili wants to push in, get that crowd control over onto Looney. Looney being the excellent player he is, he knows how to drag them out of position, and then Blizzo and Mara are able to capitalize on that. Another important thing to note is that they combine that with Mara actually on the Fire Mage. Fire Mage certainly does bring a big portion of burst, and that's how come, you know, they didn't have that much passive pressure in the game, but they got the ice block early and they got the kill suddenly, you know, through Blessing of Protection, Cauterize, a lot of major cooldowns. It was just huge damage from Wildcard.
Now, what actually changes when it's not the blind pick, right? We're going to see Wildcard now actually locking that in. Full information going to be going the way of the Mew Mew Kitty Cats. Do you think that they can play around it now that they've seen a Pika?
I think, honestly, that was just the first game at the LAN. I think they kind of got caught off guard there, like especially with the early ice block. When you're forced to use your most important defensive cooldown that quickly, it really kind of throws off the game plan, and it kind of forces you like, oh, wow, like we're going to lose soon if we don't do something right now. And I think that kind of just gets in people's heads. So I think they should try to lock the same comp and just go at it again.
Okay, just go for it again. Now we're going to be taking a look right now at what we are going to be working with on Ruins of Lordaeron as well. How does this map play into things?
Well, I think the main strength we saw from Wildcard Gaming was really Looney's mobility. So what M2KC wants to do with Ruins of Lordaeron, much smaller map. It's more difficult for Looney to escape and sort of drag Rub Cub, drag Jamili into the open, and that's going to allow them to get a lot more consistent pressure in the game, and hopefully Jamili's able to hold on to some of those shimmers a little bit more so he can actually effectively kite Blizzo, because we really didn't see that in the last game.
Do you think that this is going to be enough to really turn the tide? We talk about having full information, you've seen the comp, and now you're in much tighter quarters.
I mean, I think one of the things that we you have to consider is the Rub Cup was winning the mana game as well, right? Like, the Mistweaver does have to churn out a fair bit of inefficient healing to keep Mara stabilized for those crowd control chains, which will inevitably come from M2KC. It's the way they like to play the game. So this is going to be a big one on M2KC. They need to have better defense. I think trading out things like the Ultimate Sacrifice a little bit earlier on, rotating those shorter cooldowns so they can hold on to the significant ones, such as Ice Block, is going to be crucial because this is a small map. This is going to be a fast-paced game. M2KC really need to catch on fire here because they didn't get the ball rolling in that first game.
And also, you look at the meta. This is the meta for the Mew Mew Kitty Cats. It should be their tournament to throw. Are they just going to get knocked down in the first round, wildcard game, and trying to get themselves on match point?
Yeah, and speaking with Maro, I mean, we saw him play a lot of Frost Mage in the AWC, but playing Fire Mage is something he does a lot on ladder. And he said this composition M2KC is running, the Fire Mage, Assassination, Rogue, Holy Paladin, is something he sort of specializes in and plays a lot. So if any player could sort of come up with an answer, I feel like Maro is definitely in a good position to do so. We'll have to see what Wildcard Gaming can get done in game number two. The effective crowd control on Rub Cub last game was really crucial for their team to actually have so much pressure. Right now, you can see M2KC, they're going to be striking first. Hammer of Justice on Looney. But unfortunately, Jamillion not able to find the Polymorph or preemptive Life Cocoon on that first Kidney shot, and Maro's going to be completely fine.
Yeah, Looney just had stellar positioning once again. He was over by the side pillar. Meanwhile, Jamillion was on the central tomb. So even if he double blinked there, probably wouldn't have actually got the distance in time to actually connect to Looney, and even if he had, Blizzo would have been all over him. So once again, Wildcard Gaming, Looney in particular, with fantastic positioning in the early stages of this one. Now full fear, Blessing Protection comes in. Can they land the Polymorph? No. Good Shadow Step, Kidney Shot. Now Roasty's looking to reverse with the Vendetta.
Yeah, big damage on Maro. Rub Cub getting aggressive too with the Avenging Crusader. Maro dipping low. Looney, though, with the Thunder Focus T, massive heals. Incoming War Banner also dropped down there by Blizzo to deny any crowd control. Marl's kind of struggling right now to get the Polymorphs we saw in game number one. Rub Cub's had good position. This pillar, this tomb in the center, is really effective for Rub Cub, but a Dragon's Breath comes in. Unfortunately, Maro not able to find the Polymorph. Blizzo still all over Jamili, causing massive consistent pressure. Now Roasty's reconnecting to his target. M2KC, both mages really in this game are getting shut down quite a bit. We really haven't seen too many Polymorphs.
Yeah, certainly haven't. I mean, I think both teams have kind of taken it a little bit slower here. Rub Cub in particular, he's not really playing too aggressively. He's just line of sighting Maro, as you say, allowing Roasty's to kind of stay all over him, deny Polymorphs. And I actually think that plays into M2KC's hands. They do have the mana lead right now. They seem to have the pressure lead as well, looking potentially to force the Ice Block. Instead, Rallying Cry from Blizzo enables the Life Cocoon to come out before the Quarter Eyes. Very nicely done. Good defensive play. Now full counts for over on Rub Cub. They're trying to get damage on Jamili, but once again, fantastic positioning all over the tomb. Rub Cub denying any Polymorphs to follow that one up, and M2KC will survive.
Yeah, this is normally not how we see M2KC really play. They're playing very defensive right now. Jamili realized he kind of got baited in the last game, so instead of that, he's just going to allow Roasties to do as much work as possible. Now pushing in, potentially looking for the crowd control. There it is, Hammer of Justice. Unfortunately, gets Polymorph. Nicely done there by Maro. It actually might have been Blizzard with the Spell Reflect, but ultimately Jamili not able to find the crowd control. Double Dragon's Breath comes in. Is he going to get the Ring of Frost? Maro could be in some trouble, but he gets denied. The interrupts from Maro and Blizzard have been on point. They are just shutting down Jamili every step of the way. Ultimate Sacrifice rolls in from Rub Cub. Jamili will survive, but decent pressure here for M2KC on Amaro.
I really like that Ultimate Sacrifice from Rub Cub. It's a 2-minute cooldown as opposed to Ice Block, which is 4 or 5 minutes, so it's much more efficient of a trade. Now, if they do, you know, get another big crowd control chain with the next Combustion, Jamili could Ice Block it, and then Ultimate Sacrifice will rotate back up. So that's what we're looking at. Full Polymorph onto Rub Cub. Big pressure on Jamili. He's kiting away, though. He's been holding on to those Shimmers. Still forced into the Ice Block, though. Massive damage from Wildcard Gaming, and I mean, Wildcard Gaming, we talked to Method Black. Three of the members on that team were saying that these guys were not even competition for this one. They were super demoralized, but Swapsy was one who's like, you know what? The raw talent on this roster, you can never quite count them out. And I mean, in this one, they've just been crushing Jamili so much offense. It's so scary. I mean, Rub Cub, he's even signed four behind on mana now as well.
I think counting out Wildcard Gaming in any tournament is just completely foolish with how, you know, like you said, raw talented these players really are. Maro, Blizzo, Looney, as well as Zipai on the bench right now. These guys are phenomenal roster. M2KC, they're struggling. They're behind in this match, but there's still hope. Looney's mana isn't doing great. Full Hammer of Justice lands. Jamili looking for a Polymorph. Can he find the Ring of Frost? Unfortunately denied, and you could tell Wildcard Gaming, they had a game plan. They're playing very well defensively, offensively as well, and M2KC, they just haven't found the opening we normally see from this team. Finally, a full Polymorph lands. Looney, though, I think he actually got the preemptive life cocoon. No, he didn't, but there's just not that much damage. Marl's going to be fine. He pops his temporal shield. That should top him off. And right now, Wildcard Gaming, they're just in the driver's seat.
Yeah, I mean, Rich kind of alluded to it. There's Warriors, and then there's Blizzard, and Jamili was the one. He basically said he feared Blizzard above anyone else, and Blizzard's just been all over him. He hasn't been able to get aggressive. They just forced the Divine Shield out. There are very little defensive cooldowns left for M2KC. We're approaching Dampening, but Jamili might not make it. The ultimate sacrifice comes out in the nick of time. It was so close to being 2-0 in favor of Wildcard Gaming, but now they truly have nothing left. Ice block. They are going to force out that ice block. It's going to come down to a cutthroat finish.
Yeah, really nicely done by M2KC. Jamili surviving on 5% health. I still think he has his cauterize available, so that cheap death effect for Jamili is still going to be active. But Rub Cup with no cooldowns, he's really going to struggle. Polymorph lands on Looney. Marl gets interrupted. Roasty all over him. This is danger time for both these teams. Full kidney shot lands on Marl. Jamili still getting low. Blizzo chopping him up. He's caught into a leg sweep. And the cauterize is going to do nothing. Wildcard Gaming up 2-0 in the series.
Oh, man. You say that that one's going to be a cutthroat finish. There was definitely pressure on both sides. But to see this happen, to see them already 2-0 up
incredible.
In this series. I mean, okay, for anybody who doesn't know exactly how important it is on the side of the Mew Mew Kitty Cats to do well, because they didn't have the best showing in the first season. I mean, pretty much didn't even exist, right? I mean, when you talk about that first season and not having a strong performance, it's all on you. You need to be one of the top two teams. And now we may see the entire field of play change, Pika.
Yeah, this last game was absolutely ridiculous. That was as close as it gets, really. It's just one global each way, but Wildcard Gaming able to secure that kill at the very end there. I think just M2KC just got the setups a little too late. I would have loved to see that momentum coming through earlier, but Looney and Mario just such incredible positioning defensively. Just the fact that they stand so far apart makes it so hard to get that crowd control on them. And eventually because Blizzo is just doing so much damage that without those setups, eventually Blizzo and them should eventually win. And that's what happens here, just very, very close here. Nice leg sweep there, and the cauterize just does nothing at this point in the game because of the Maledict.
Man, now going into the next game, is the onus going to be on the side of the Mew Mew Kitty Cats to change something? I mean, this is the comp that everybody was scared of. You talk about just Rogue Mage in general and saying that this is going to be something. I mean, we're more so talking about RMD, but when you talk about Rogue Mage and just the strength, the sheer strength of having these two classes together, that seemed to be the boogeyman of this tournament and might go down in the first round. Do you think that they will change anything here?
I'm honestly not sure what they can change. I mean, we've been watching them prepare some compositions, but I think Wildcards is actually pretty well-rounded. Like, the Mage and the Warrior is going to be fine into any cleave composition that M2KC could play. We've heard rumors of the Shadow Priest. I don't think you want to play Shadow Priest into Mage Warrior either, so I think they're kind of locked in to this Mage Rogue Paladin. And, I mean, we talk about the Mage Rogue being often paired with the Druid, in this occasion being paired with the Paladin. I actually think the Paladin version is more scary for Looney to deal with, which really speaks testament to how good of a healer this guy is, because, I mean, sure, in that last game, a lot of their cooldowns were forced out, but he's been dealing with it really, really well. There's not been a single point where Venruki or I have even remotely thought to say, oh, that was a bit of a mistake from Looney. He's been trading perfectly. And, I mean, it's off of that perfect play, because I don't think that this is a matchup they necessarily have an advantage in.
I mean, already now, when I start looking at this series, I'm in a spiral of mathematics, right? This just changes the entire field of play. I gotta crunch the numbers right now.
I need steam.
You gotta actually think about it, because if we do see one of the Rogue Mage drop down early, we might see something completely happen for this tournament. It's gonna change so many matchups. I'm gonna crunch the numbers. When we return, we're gonna see, is this series going to be a 3-0? All right, I crunched the numbers, and ultimately, the equation results in a scenario where Wildcard Gaming win this game. They win the whole series. Now, that's
something.
Took me a little while to figure it out. It might be a little bit rusty.
He had me double check his work.
It's been a while. Yeah,
Give him a smiley face sticker at the end.
I did.
Do not start the smiley face mumbo jumbo. The only thing that I want to start is this game, and luckily we are doing just that. Guys, this is Match Point. This can determine the series. It's not the way we expected it to go, and we were seeing everybody stick to their guns. Wildcard Gaming trying to knock down the Mew Mew Kitty Cats.
I really feel like Wildcard Gaming, they've thrown M2KC a curveball, and so far, M2KC, they haven't been able to really handle it. I feel like M2KC, they need to play a little bit more aggressive, just kind of stick to their guns, play as offensively as possible. I think Blizzo with his war banner has been able to really deny that initial crowd control, but M2KC, they need to push through, because if they're going to play a passive game, I just feel like the consistent damage Blizzo is able to put out is just really overwhelming Rub Cub.
Yeah, I mean, I think the curveball is a perfect way of describing it. Basically, they've thrown the kitty cat to curveball, and Jamili's still in the corner playing with that ball. He needs to get his head in the game here for game three as we go up against Wildcard Gaming. I really think the thing is offense. Like, last game, we saw them play a very defensive game, and it didn't seem to work out. In fact, for me, it was slightly worse than game one. So I think if they go in, get very, very aggressive here, get the crowd control early on to Looney, potentially even attacking Blizzo could be an option. Attacking Looney, they could swap it up a lot here in this one. Blizzo, we've talked about it in the backstage. Arms Warrior is definitely a little bit scary, and Rub Cub recognizes that. He's playing very aggressively with his cooldowns, already using out the Divine Shield, the Ultimate Sacrifice. He wants to enable Jamili to get aggressive, get those crowd controls over onto Looney, because they have Force 2 trinkets, they have the Vendetta available. I think they're going to go for a swap either onto Blizzo or Looney.
Yeah, but Rub Cub, he's already burned through so much. He does have his Avenging Crusader. That is the last sort of lifeline for M2KC. Jamili, of course, with that Ice Block, but just pressure in favor of Wildcard Gaming once again. Marl trinkets out of the Kidney Shot. Full Hammer of Justice on Looney. M2KC, can they get the crowd control that they need? Smoke Bomb drops out to protect Jamili from Marl's damage. That is enough to keep him alive right now. Mana still in favor of Looney and Wildcard Gaming. Finally, some decent control coming in, but for M2KC, we really want to see them get the crowd control on Looney, start getting those consistent setups. Right now, no one on Wildcard Gaming has a trinket, and this is the moment where they need to strike with a full Kidney Shot on Marl, full Polymorph on Looney. And if they can get that done, they can get the Ice Block for Marl.
Yeah, that was actually a bit of a miscommunication on M2KC there, and you can see it because we have this new UI element in the center. You can follow the target, see their buffs, debuffs. Marl is actually able to dispel Rub Cub's Blessing of Protection and remove the Vendetta from Roasties almost immediately, completely shutting down one of their biggest offensive cooldowns, quite honestly. M2KC all over the place in this game. Rub Cub now caught up in crowd control. No breakers available. Full Stormbolt. Jamili, are you going to have to use the Ice Block? It looks likely. There it is. The massive defensive cooldown. Offensives downs. Defensives down. M2KC struggling here in game three.
This is match point. Wildcard Gaming 2-0 up in this series. They win this game, and it's looking like they might. I mean, right now, Maro, he's got the combustion rolling back up. Blizzo has a lot of damage available with that avatar as well. Jamili, no lifelines. Rub Cub, no defensive cooldowns. 13 seconds left on the ultimate sacrifice. They have to hold on. Interrupt on Marl. Jamili trying to get control of the game right now. Spamming out some polymorphs on Blizzo, but Blizzo rolls in. Massive damage incoming. Dragon's Breath denies it a little bit, but Jamili just holding on by a thread. He's got the cauterize. Is it going to be able to keep him alive? He's running. He's trying to hide, but the Stormbolt on Rub Cub denies any heals. Wildcard Gaming, complete dominant, the dominating performance in game or series number one of this tournament. That is completely unexpected and honestly completely unbelievable.
This is not what we expected at all. The Mew Mew Kitty Cats are going to be going down in their first series. It looks like Wildcard Gaming was the team that's not kitten around. Now let's actually talk about why it happened and talk about whether or not this composition is the real deal, if it's going to be able to go up against some of the other rogue mages, Pika.
I think I'm actually so shocked that this just happened. I think this is the only team in the entire world that could bring a Mistweaver Monk into Arena right now and actually have a 3-0 performance versus one of the most dominant rogue mages in the game right now. It just seems like M2KC was not able to ever get enough pressure to swing the game in their favor, and because of that, Wildcard Gaming can just go full offensive at all times, and it is so hard to ever recover when you're already this far behind in the game. Especially they've had really good Maldic timings as well, because Maldic is denying that huge cauterized heal that Fire Mages have, so usually it's basically being rendered worthless.
Now, I'm going to throw you a tough question here, and already you're doing a fantastic job. We love having you up here.
Thank you.
So I'm going to throw you a hard question.
All right, sounds good. I'm ready.
When we actually watch these games, I feel like one of the things we always try to do as casters is we try to figure out, okay, who played well? Is this somebody playing well that made the match go this way, or is it somebody playing poorly that made the match go this way? Wildcard Gaming definitely looked good, but do you think this is an element of the Mew Mew Kitty Cats not looking as good as they did online?
I think maybe they got a bit of a rough start, but I don't think this is a matter of just playing bad or anything. I think this is just Looney and Maro being so incredibly good defensively together. Their positioning makes it so difficult for the team of M2KC to do their normal CC setup where they get all their damage and pressure from. Just by the fact, simple fact, they're just so far away from each other. Jamilia is always stuck with the choice of, okay, am I going to get the follow-up sheep off the Hodge, or am I going to try to do damage to the kill target? And they keep getting stuck in that situation, and they can't get the defensive cooldowns forced before it's too late.
Man, you talk about the synergy between these two players. We got one of them on the stage right now. Let's hear what Mauro has to say after that win.
Hey guys, I'm here with Mauro. Now, before that series, you really didn't seem like you thought you were going to win that. How are you feeling now?
Obviously feeling amazing. We kind of had the goal to like at least win one series here because we feel like we are not playing the best comps right now. But I mean, we kind of achieved that goal now, so we're obviously very happy.
Now, M2KC, they have those cat ears. Were those a little intimidating for you?
Not really.
No? Didn't think they have any claws coming out of nowhere?
I mean, we were obviously like, we didn't really know what to expect from them. I mean, we knew they were like going to play really offensive, so it was going to be fast games. But I think we dealt really good with it, and I think everyone played really good this series.
Now, you picked the Warrior Mage Monk comp, and I think it's obvious they weren't expecting that. What was the decision behind that?
So, like, a few weeks ago, we kind of knew already that we were going to play Warrior Mage. So it was just about playing Monk or Resto Druid. And we kind of decided to play Monk because we feel like it's overall stronger, even if you would play, like, Arcane Mage maybe or some other spec. And also, I think the matchup is really, like, safe in a sense. You can kill without any, like, CC. So we kind of just thought it would be better to play Fire Mage and Monk.
All right, well, thank you so much. We're going to catch back up with them at the desk. Thank you.
Definitely nice to hear from Mauro. I mean, time and time again, I've been in situations where I've thought Mauro is the best mage competing. I've thought it many times. I think this year, there were a lot of times where I've said it and people have definitely contested me, and I think it was really fair. But when we actually do look at them in this position, where they're playing in the land environment, all of a sudden, are you considering Wildcard a bigger threat than you necessarily did at the beginning of the day today before we got to see the teams play?
Well, it's weird because in the summer season, it really felt like Rogue Mage, Paladin, Rogue Mage Druid couldn't lose to really anything. But seeing some of the war games and, you know, the preparations these teams have been putting in and what teams have been able to figure out, I'm kind of leaning away from that a little bit. I feel like there are some answers. I feel like still Rogue Mage is really strong and definitely has the potential to win, but they have to play well. It's not a free win anymore. People are coming up with different compositions and teams are prepared because they have to be. If you can't beat Rogue Mage, you're not going to win this tournament.
Yeah, I mean, typically after watching a game like that, you know, very quickly I would go to Twitter to make sure I get my appropriate amount of NaCl. It's a chemical compound that the human body needs to function, and usually Job puts out a lot of that into the environment. It's very crucial to surviving for me. I have him on notification, but something interesting that I saw on Twitter that actually deviates from that idea as well of Rogue Mages necessarily being the strongest thing was something you tweeted out today, and when you were actually talking about some of your predictions for the tournament, do you really think some of these cleaving compositions are going to be stronger?
Yeah, I changed my prediction from actually the Mew Mew Kitty Cats. I thought they would potentially win, but now I'm going with Method Orange. I feel like these cleave setups really are strong. We haven't seen them showcased yet in this tournament, but man, that Frost Death Knight looks nasty, and I think the Restoration Shaman paired with the Frost Death Knight and then a Mistweaver or a Windwalker Monk and a, you know, a Demon Hunter, which is what Trill plays, just gives Method Orange the perfect formula of compositions to take a win.
And looking at the bracket right now, Healing Set, the first thing that I want to think about is how much does the Mew Mew Kitty Cats being knocked out in the first round start to change what we think about the lay of the land and how this side of the bracket actually looks?
Well, firstly, I've got to say, for Diabolus and Gosu Kuri, it raises the stakes seeing Wildcard being on this level of form, because whoever loses this next series will go up against M2KC, which is not a first-round lower bracket that you want to be facing at all. So certainly scary for these next two teams. In terms of overall kind of metagame, I think Venriki was kind of on the money that, you know, these teams have had weeks to figure out what they want to play into Rogue Mage. Whether it'll work or not is, I mean, that's what we're here to find out, right? There's five teams potentially that could be playing the Rogue Mage here out of eight. So the other three certainly have been bringing top caliber compositions to match that, whether it be Frost Death Knights or whether it be the Destruction Warlocks. And I'm very curious to see as the day continues to go on whether teams will be able to kind of emulate what Wildcard did here. I don't think anyone else will be running the Warrior Mage to that level, but certainly there are other things such as those cleave compositions, which are going to be very interesting to see how they play out.
I want to deep dive on the Death Knight for just a second here, because it's definitely been kind of the talk of the town, one of the other things that we really want to look out for. What is it about Frost Death Knight that does make it such a popular pick?
Right now, this is like a recent discovery. Basically, all the people that could play on Hoi DK instantly swap to Frost DK. Because if you're able to play on Hoi, you're very well easily able to play Frost. And basically what Frost DK does is it sits on a target and it has a talent called Heartstop Delirium. And basically what it does is it makes it so the person has increased cooldowns on every single button possible. So it's impossible to get away from the Frost Death Knight. And Frost DKs already do a ton of damage by default. So on top of that, their shutdown potential and just their control of the game just increases instantly.
Not to be a history nerd right now, but I remember last year, opening week, one of the big discoveries was Death Knights. And I feel like this has happened so many times. You were in a position where you actually had to deal with it last time. It was all of a sudden the Death Knight came out of nowhere.
Yeah, I think Death Knights are just a great pick for tournaments especially. They're just such a tanky class. They do a ton of damage. They have infinite shutdown potential. And you don't really have to worry about setting up a lot of crowd control or anything like that. It kind of just all comes naturally just by doing your damage rotation. So I think it's always a great pick in tournaments. And usually those compositions that the DKs fit into are always just very tanky and very high pressure.
A lot to think about right now in the tournament. The first series already being somewhat of an upset. We're going to get the next one started up here in just a few seconds. And guys, we've already talked about just how crazy this tournament is going to be. Unlike other lands, we are figuring out two teams that will be going. And then we're also going to see where the qualification points are going to land these teams. You don't want to go anywhere. The day is already moving at rapid speed. We got our next series right after this.